Testament, it is absolutely taken out. In fact, we can see that primarily in Christ, in the way he treated an adulterous woman, and in the way he even reprimanded Paul when he was on his way to persecute the Christians. So zero toleration. So there was a difference in God's way of approaching his people. Now, putting that side by side also with the church, in spite of the fact that the church has already received the Old and the New Testament, we would see that even in history, the church also tolerated the Inquisition. There was a time when heretics are being burned and they are being tolerated by the church. But now, of course, there was zero toleration. Now, when we look at that side by side, are these responses historically conditioned? Meaning to say, by tolerating such kind of punishment, can that be also a way of expressing mercy during that period? And by tolerating Inquisition during that period in the church, can it also be a way of expressing mercy during that period? Because the people may not be something like that. But today, it, of course, it's zero toleration.
Okay. So to answer that question, it's a good observation and something that we should be clear about. Now, let me bring out these two presuppositions of the faith. The first is revelation happens in history. Second, that revelation is progressive. In a way, that is the so-called divine pedagogy. In history. First, revelation happens in history. God makes himself known in history. This is something that is unique of the Judeo-Christian tradition. Among the Greeks, they know God through myths, through their philosophy. Among the indigenous peoples, they know God through creation, by observing creation. There are Eastern religions that they would know God through meditation, like Buddhism, enlightenment. And some through visions, like Muhammad, had his own vision of God. But for us Christians and Jews, no, we know God more through history. God makes use of history in order to reveal himself. Okay? So when you make use of history, you make use of historical conditions. So even the Bible is conditioned by history. For example, in the Bible, their belief in the world is that the world is flat. Not that it is like our planetary system. They don't have that concept. Ang concept nila ng cosmology is different from our concept of cosmology. And we cannot fault them on that. Yan yung alam nila. Wala silang idea about the law of gravity, which only was discovered by Newton 250 years ago. Second, because it is in history, revelation is progressive. He did not tell us everything. But little by little, there is this divine pedagogy. God is teaching us through historical events. Now, application yan sa atin. Yung mga tao noon, matatapang, mababangis. It's because they don't have any systems of laws. In fact, the oldest law that we have is the law of Hammurabi. Was about 1500 BC lang. So before that, wala silang laws. So how can you have order among people? Only through fear. You can protect society only through fear. Kepampanakot. No? Kaya nga, sa panahon ni Cain, nung pinatay niya ang kanyang kapatid, pinarusahan sa ng Diyos that he will be moving around the earth, then, how can I be if people meet me? I might not survive. Kaya yung batas, if anybody touches Cain, he will be punished 7 times. But that punishment of 7 times, revenge, somehow was mitigated in the law of Moses, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. Kung ano lang ang kinuha sa'yo, yan ang pupunin mo. Which we even don't follow now. Even the Israelis. May isang Israeli soldier na pinatay, papatay sila ng 5 Palestinians. Hindi nga isa sa isa. So hindi pa nga sinusundan sa ating panahon ngayon. So that was how violent they are. Somehow violence was the way of safeguarding themselves. That's why the more children you have, the better. You have more protection from the violence of others. Yan yung situation. So somehow there is this divine pedagogy that little by little, God is trying to educate us. Hindi ganyan, hindi ganyan, hindi ganyan. Let's take it this way. Yung mga anak nyo na nagkakamali, sa simula, nung sila yung mga 2 or 1 year old, you cannot explain to them. Kaya anong parusa ay masala? Papaluin. It's the only language that they know. When they feel a little bit of hurt. But ngayon na sila ay 17 years old na. Paano ko na yung palo? Kailangan mo na sila kausapin. Before, when they did not follow you, okay, no, suffer. You face the wall. Gawin mo yan sa teenager, eh, pagkatawalan. See, does that mean that you don't love them? But was that? That was the language that they knew then. That is your pedagogy. No, alam niyo naman kayo mga katikista. Iba yung pagdidisiplina sa mga grade 1. Hindi mahirap makiusap sa grade 1. Pero sa mga fourth year, kailangan mo na makiusapan yan. No? So there are different approaches. So this also in the Bible. But although we have this strong hand of God in the Bible, but already at that time, there was already the concept of compassion. At ini-stress na yun. I hope it answers. So, even now also, even now, when you think about the Middle Ages, 500, 700 years ago, people were very violent. But now, there are more consciousness. Before, they had no consciousness of the rights of the women. But now, there's more consciousness about the rights of women. before there is no consciousness about the rights of children. But now my child rights na tayo. So there is more refinement now. And we don't know, probably later on, after 50 years, there may be other still refinements of our morality that we do not have now. The Declaration of Human Rights was done only in 1945. Before that, there was no consciousness of human rights. Right to food, right to education, right to expression, wala. So nag-i-improve ang humanity still. There is the progression.
The progression in the progressive.
So this is a progression in our humanity. We are being refined. Kaya ang masama, like with the Muslims, that they didn't see any improvement at all in history, na hanggang ngayon, ganun pa rin, papupugot pa rin ang ulo. Papuputo pa rin ang kamay. Ang kanilang punishment sa Sharia law. And then they want to go back to it. Iba na ang sitwasyon ngayon. Okay, any question?
Yes. Regarding your question regarding why people seem to go for death penalty, I remember one time I was reading in the Facebook there, a friend of mine posted a video defending pro-life, why death penalty should not be accepted. And then the comments there, some of them are from our parish. I was surprised that they were for death penalty. Then I observed that the reason why they went for death penalty is because they're not affected. And they feel, I think they're disconnected with the people who will suffer or who will be punished. They believe that as long as you're not doing anything wrong, you will not be affected. And finally, there's this disconnection that they can't see themselves at the other side. Of the ones who need mercy, so that's how I see it. And I think one of the answers, perhaps to this problem, is a sense of community. They really feel this. They don't see themselves in other people. The basic concept of do not do to others what you don't want others to do to you. They can't. I don't even think that they think of those things or do to others what you would want others to do to you. But it doesn't even enter their mind. So that's how I see it.
So in a way, it comes with a culture of individualism. Thinking only about yourself, about your family. And that's why we have to counter that. No, if that is one reason, we have to counter that in your catechism, in your teaching. Again, go back to Jesus. Jesus, although he was God, he became man. He became like one of us to the sinabi sa Hebrews. So that he could be merciful. He need not be. He could have just stayed in heaven and punished us. But he went out of his way to take our human situation, to understand us. Kaya tama yung sinabi mo, we have to learn how to put ourselves in the shoes of others. And how do we do that? One way of doing that is by means of exposure, immersion. Expose them, immerse them in the situations of others. Dali mo sa jail, ipakiusap sa mga bilanggo so that makita ang pagkatao nila. Dali mo sa mga mahihirap, makipag-usap doon. So makita, tao din pala yan, nagsisikap din pala yan. Then, may magbabagong pananaw. So, hindi lang pagtuturo. Yung experiential. dahil sa mga magsasaka. Mag-expose to, makipag-usap sa kanila. Exposure, immersion. That's very catechetical. May mga, when I was still a young priest, I was speaking about social issues and sa mga taga Makati, and somehow I was able to convince some of them to have exposure among the urban poor, to live with the urban poor for one weekend. Makitira sa kanila, saan sila natutulong, saan sila naliligo, ang pagkain nila, makitira sa kanila. You know, after more than 25 years, when I meet them, they still remember their own experience. Malaki ang dating. Ang dami na nilang retreat na dinaluhan, kalimutan nila yung mga retreat. Ito mga experience na ito, malakas na dating. I don't know if that can also be done in your catechetical program. Of course, there will be processing afterwards, so that they will see the reason for their experience. Yes.
Sa inyo pong palagay, late po ba tayo sa evangelization ng Pilipinas sa context na meron ngayon?
O, paano mo sabihin na late?
Kasi parang sa kapo tayo nagkagan ito, kaya parang nag-review tayo, then mabalik is tayo sa Saba ulit. Evangelization. Kasi ito nga po yung mission ng death penalty. Parang sabi nyo kanina, mas marami yung kumuho kaysa sa pag-ibig.
In a way, hindi naman tayo naging lay. Naging pabaya tayo.
Yeah.
Okay. So, there were efforts already with some groups, with some catechists, some dioceses, pero marami ay tulong pa rin. Kahit na nga ngayon, no, galing kayo sa iba't ibang diocese, ilang diocese na represented dito? Ilang lang, hindi naaabot ang 20 out of 89 dioceses. No, ibig sabihin ng iba, wala pa rin in-offer na ito. I'm sure also before, marami na rin in-offer. No, pero hindi naman na binigyan ng halaga. So, nagpapaya tayo.
Yes. This is another question, Bishop. Kasi, malakas ito sa Mindanao. Kasi, correct me if I'm wrong, kasi minsan nakarinig kami ng balita sa TV, yung there was this photo exhibit in suburb ng Pasig City ba yun? Yung parang sinastandalize yung nilagyan ng condom, ganun-ganun.
UP.
Oo. CCP. So, this was very strong in our place in Mindanao because sabi ng mga tao, pag ginawa yan sa mga Muslim, patay talaga yan, parang ganun. Kaya nasabi ko, kasi compassionate tayo, kasi forgiving tayo, mga Christians, kaya hindi na tayo nag-react, yung mga Catholics hindi na nag-react. My question is, kailan, when to defend our faith? Kailan ba natin pwedeng gamitin yung parang, we have to, kasi parang, para sa mga Muslims, pag nakita sila ng gano'n, parang they are so, pero sa atin parang, okay lang yun. Mayroon pa nga, they are so open-minded, obsolete na yung mga ano. My question is, kailan ba yung awareness ng Catholic, ng tayo na, pwede din tayo magdumipensa.
Kaya nga dapat, although there are many rights now that are being said, right of information, right of expression, but for every right, there are also limits. And we should also take care na itong mga limits na ito that is needed by society ay ma-respect. So probably, there's a lack of discernment among us. But more than a lack of discernment, wala talagang paninindigan. Wala talagang paninindigan na sabihin na yan ay mali. No, kahit sa isang judicial killing. wala sa ninindigan, nagpapabaya tayo. Nagpapabaya tayo. Of course, our reaction should not be like the reactions of the Muslim na papatay din sila. Na hindi naman tama yun. But we should have our objections registered. Not condemned. As we have the right to bring it out, we have the right to say it's wrong. Bakit kayo lang ang may right na magpahayag not? Wala kaming right na magsilita na mali yun. At wala naman tayong reaction. That's why part of your catechism lesson is that people should be able to stand up for our faith. Give them clear ideas and later on act on these ideas. Not just to know what is right and what is wrong, but to act on them. It's your problema. And right now, we can act on them. Gamitin nyo lang yung Facebook nyo. Magsalita lang kayo. Ay, ba't natin yung ginagamit? We cannot say that I cannot do anything. Because with the technology now, we can do something. Ang tinitingnan po nga, sa ating mga groups, sa ating mga pastoral councils, ang pinagmimitingan natin palagi ay mga internal affairs lang. Kailan yung piyesta, anong gagawin natin ngayon sa parakol natin, kung nasisira na yung sibahan natin, saan yung bubunin yung sweldo ng katekista. So, mga yan. But we never discuss the problems of society. So that we can discern together. At ang daming problema ng lipunan. Yan, death penalty, civil killing, Benham rights, kahit ang importation ng bigas, ang pagtataas ng kuryente. So we don't discuss it, so we don't analyze, so we don't speak out as groups in the church. So, yan din, kulang din tayo sa catechesis natin sa social aspects of the faith. The social obligations of the faith. Mahina tayo sa ating Catholic social obligations. Kaya, check nyo ka, alam ko gumagawa kayo ng inyong mga syllabus. Kasama din ba dyan ang Catholic social teachings? Kasama din ba dyan? Essential din yan ang ating faith, hindi lang sacraments. No? Yes.
Bishop, in answer to that, I've been in the school for 18 years, and although we have our strong pastoral activities, but inside the classroom, there is still more discussions on the basics of the faith rather than doing something for it. So now that in the grade 11 and 12, when the grade 11 and 12 entered, and we were searching for something to teach for catechesis, that this is the only time that the Catholic social teaching was being given, and it is always labeled as the best kept secret of the church. But one of the observations then, Bishop, in addition, is that even among the young people nowadays, they seem, I'm just not so sure, but upon observation, they seem to equate mercy with, as long as I am not being hurt, I will also not hurt you. But when you need help, just ask, just say, and that's the time that I will help. But as long as no one is telling them to help,
If that is the case, then there is something that you can do. Kung mahirap mag-expose sila, dadalhin mo pa sa mga katutubo, sa mga mangingisda, pwede namang dalhin nyo ang katutubo sa classroom. dalhin niyo ang mangingisan sa classroom, ipakwento sa kanila, ito po yung buhay namin, ito yung problema namin. Ito yung kailangan namin ng tulong. So that they can see also from the point of view of the poor, what would be needed. You can bring there a jail warden. Pakita yung buhay sa jail, kung hindi siya madala sa jail. Idalhin yung dyan ng isang cancer patient. Anong naranasan niya? Dalhin yung dyan ng isang bulam na magsalita sa mga tao. And that would have more impact. Kaya kung ang sabi natin yung mga basics of the faith, how to pray the rosary, how to go to confession, huwag yan ang pag-uusapan. That's why many people disengage the faith with the experience of life. Kaya basta akong nag-uumpisa, basta ako nag-rosary, okay ako. Pero experience of wala, kasi hindi naman natin tinuro sa kanila. Di ba? So yan, dalhin yung mga taong, dalhin yung karanasan na yun dito. At kuminsan, pwede pang magawa yan ngayon, marami na tayong mga videos. Mga ipalabas. Anong iyari sa isang baha? Anong iyari sa ganon? So may mga malikhain that will bring them in touch with society. And help them to reflect over this. Wala bang sinasabi ang Diyos yan? Sabi natin, liberation happens in this way. Sa nangyayari, ito wala bang sinasabi ang Diyos dyan. And probably, they would be more engaged with the faith knowing that.
Regarding the death penalty, when we all schools were encouraged to respond, no, to at least show their support to the call of the church, we were surprised that there are teachers who are pro death penalty, and we talked about it. And one problem that we saw was the fact that the fever of election, it was full of hate. No, many of our teachers are millennials, and therefore they also depend so much on social media, and it was full of hate that they were not able to separate the issue of this issue with the current president. Now, for them, if they see it as, or they saw it as something like still against the president, because some of them voted for the current president. And we said, in fact, our directress, Sister Nebre, said, short of saying, what's your business here teaching in Catholic school when in fact you are teaching here and you are pro death penalty? You don't understand you're being a Christian, you're being a Catholic. And our worry is the fact that, you know, they will be facing students, similar with the catechist. Who knows? You might ask also survey your own diocese. No, you might have catechists that also believe in the penalty. And when they face the kids, that's the what will they say? What will they explain to the kids? And maybe they will not be showing their but they will not be showing their stand against the penalty. That's why similar with in our school, the director was very firm in saying, short in saying, what's your business here? So you better leave the school if that's your stand. I think we have come to that point where we have to make a stand and be strong about it. Just as Bishop said, we have to show also our, so in our community,